As a visiting minister, I should introduce myself, although I'm sure most all of you know who I am, because this is not the first time it's been my privilege to stand on the pulpit here at Maranatha Church, but I'm Reverend Gregg Martin, and I'm very happy to be here to share this time of worship with the congregation, and may the Lord bless us each and every one as we lift up our hearts and praise the Lord this Sabbath morning. I've been asked to announce that after the service, there will be, for the first time in 2 years, coffee served. So if you're able to stay and enjoy a time of fellowship, you're most welcome to do so. Let's have an opening prayer. Father in heaven, we are gathered here in this house of prayer to worship you, the one true living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We pray for your blessing upon us as we lift up our hearts in praise and adoration, as we listen to your word, and as we enjoy Christian fellowship. Bless us, keep us in your care, we ask in Jesus' name, amen. And now we have a song of praise, Good, Good Father.
Come into the presence of our holy God, expecting to meet with God. We come to sing his praise. And the least boys were supposed to lead this morning. They came down with COVID. So they got us to fill in. So be patient with us if we don't have everything perfect.
That I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Will you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. So undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think. As you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still into love. Love, love, my good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. What a faithful God. What a faithful God. What a faithful God you are to us.
Hear now the call to worship, familiar words from the Gospel of John. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Come to the Lord, who is rich in grace. Approach our God, who is full of mercy. Our help stands in the name of the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you, from God the Father, and from Jesus Christ, his Son, by the working of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This is the fourth Sunday in Lent, a time Christians historically have reflected upon their lives, identified sin, and repented of it. Of course, these are things we should always be doing. But there's something about the weeks leading up to Good Friday and Easter that makes one consider the cross and the price that was paid for our sin. Hear these words from 1 John 1, verses 8 and 9. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us pray together a prayer of confession. Holy God, as we worship you this day, we do not want to be people who deceive ourselves. Instead, we want to clearly see who you are and clearly see who we are. We cannot claim to be without sin, so we confess our sin before you, trusting that you are indeed faithful and just, and that you will forgive us our sins and purify us from all our righteousness. Hear our prayer, for we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Hear these words of assurance from Scripture. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. As the church today, we share the good news about new life in Christ, about sins forgiven, and the restoration of our relationship with God, who made us, who created us in God's image, and who loves us even more than we can imagine. At this time, there is a song of commitment, "It Is Well With My Soul," and I believe you can be seated.
With this message of assurance, we can definitely say it is well with our soul. Thank you.
God has clearly instructed us with rules for holy living. That rule we find in the Ten Commandments, which God himself wrote with his finger on two tablets of stone and gave them to his servant Moses. Let us hear these words with attention, and let us go forth from our worship into the week ahead with the will and determination to live by these good commandments. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything, in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers, to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Jesus, who in the gospel said, "Not one jot or tittle, not one little mark of the law will ever disappear," Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and great commandment. And a second like unto it is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all of God's law and the prophets." Let's turn now in our hearts and join together in a time of prayer before the throne of God. Heavenly Father, as we gather once again as a Christian congregation here in this sanctuary, we thank you and praise you, for you are our Creator. You are the God of our salvation. And by the powerful work of the Holy Spirit, you sanctify us. And as part of the Spirit's work, when we awakened this morning, you put into our hearts the desire to come and worship, to praise and glorify you here in this sanctuary, together with fellow Christians. And Lord, for this we are grateful. We thank you and we acknowledge your sovereign work. We pray, Lord, for this congregation. We thank you for each and every member, for all those who attend. We thank you, too, that there are those who are willing to serve in various ways, as elders and deacons, as those who prepare the bulletin, those who run the audiovisual system, those who clean the church. Lord God, we know that without willing hearts, congregational life would not be able to go on, and we thank you for each and every one, for each and every act of service. And we pray, Lord, that this will continue and that your blessing will be poured out upon everyone who is a part of the Maranatha congregation here. We pray not only for ourselves, but Heavenly Father, we also bring before your throne of grace all true Christian churches. Wherever your word is proclaimed in truth this Lord's day, bless the preaching of your word. May it touch many hearts. May it lead to the conversion of souls. May it strengthen and encourage the faith of Christians here at home and indeed around the world. Lord God, we pray for the particular work of missions that this congregation supports. Be with these ministries, Lord. We pray that faithful missionaries may see fruit upon their labor. We also pray, Lord God, as in our own day and age, the gospel has literally gone out to the ends of the earth, that you will gather in all your people, that at last the number of the elect will be complete, and that our Lord Jesus will return to us in glory on the clouds of heaven, and usher in the last day when we, your people, will be gathered to you to rejoice in your presence forever. Until that time, we ask that by the working of the Holy Spirit, the church may be kept faithful, pure, and true. And we also pray, Lord God, for those who need the touch of your loving hand in a special way. There are those of this congregation who are sick. Bless them with healing, we pray you. There are those who are shut in. May they find peace of heart. And we pray that there will be those who, in Christian love, will visit the shut-ins to encourage them. Lord God, we pray for all in the estates and conditions in which we find ourselves. We pray for the younger ones, for students at school and university and colleges and technical schools. Gracious Lord, be with them as they prepare themselves, and we ask that they will prepare themselves for lives of service, using their talents in ways that glorify you. We pray for married couples, that husbands and wives will live together in love and devotion and faithfulness, that parents will raise their children in the fear and admonition of your most holy name, that children will honor and obey their parents according to the commandment so that they may live long. And we ask too, Lord God, that you will be with those who are single in this earthly life, that they may dedicate themselves to you and to your service. Be with those who are older and feel the frailty of age creep upon them. Give them strength and encouragement, Lord, knowing that you are always with them. In whatever estate or condition we may find ourselves, O Lord, help us to love and serve you with all our heart and soul and mind and strength. And remembering what your word teaches us, we pray also for the civil government, for all those here in Canada who hold authority under Her Majesty the Queen, for the federal government and our province of Ontario, and for the local municipalities in which we live. We pray that those who hold political office will do so humbly and with a desire to serve, and may they realize also that at last the day will come when they will give an account not to the voters, but to you, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We pray for the courts of justice and the magistrates of this land, that they may administer the law in fear of you alone and not be partial in any way, shape, or form. Lord God, we also pray for our troubled world. We know that Jesus Christ alone is the Prince of Peace, and only at the fullness of the coming of His kingdom will true, lasting peace be established. In the meantime, O Lord, how the world suffers. We pray again for the people of the Ukraine, as they are subject to vicious bombardments, suffering and death on a massive scale. O Lord, this troubles us. We grieve for this, and we pray that this war will cease and that you will turn the hearts of those who are waging this war, that they may realize that the shedding of innocent blood is one of the things that makes you most angry, and that you will certainly judge and punish those who shed innocent blood. O Lord God, we pray for peace, We pray that the peoples of this world may enjoy a reasonable prosperity, for we know that many in this world suffer because of extreme poverty. And grant that we here in Canada, so many of us who enjoy a very great measure of prosperity, will be thankful and will not love this world and the things of this world, which is so easy for us human beings to do. Lord, hear this our prayer. Together with the unspoken prayers of our hearts, we bring all this before your throne of grace in the holy and precious name of Jesus Christ, our mediator and advocate. Amen. The hymn of preparation will be, "Breathe on me, awake, awake."
Stand up and we'll sing the song. We're going to read a passage in a moment about the disciples falling asleep. The disciples might as well be us at times. So let's ask the Lord to awake our souls and our minds to his word.
Breathe on me, breath of God, breathe on me. Breathe on me, breath of God, breathe on me. I come alive, I'm alive when you breathe on me. I come alive, I'm alive when you breathe on me. Awake, awake, awake my soul. God, resurrect these bones from death to life, for you alone. Awake my soul. Speak to me, word of God, speak to me. Speak to me, word of God, speak to me. I come alive, I'm alive when you speak to me. Oh, I come alive, I'm alive when you speak to me. Awake, awake, awake my soul. God, resurrect these bones from death to life, for you alone. Awake my soul. Awake, awake, awake my soul. God, resurrect these bones from death to life, for you alone. Awake my soul.
This morning's scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 26, and we'll start reading at verse 36 and read through verse 56, which will be our text. So Matthew 26, beginning with verse 36. Hear now the word of the Lord. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet, not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you men not keep watch with me 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray, so that you do not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Friend, do what you came for." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him, "for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you not think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that says it must happen this way?" At that time, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. And for our text this morning, those last words of verse 56, "Then all the disciples deserted him and fled." Congregation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we draw ever nearer to our yearly remembrance of Jesus' passion, his suffering, and his death on the cross at Good Friday, often we turn to these closing chapters of the Gospels, and there we read the accounts of all that Jesus suffered, of all that he underwent for our salvation. These words tell us much about God's love. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son as a sacrifice for sin. Jesus so loved his elect people that he willingly gave his life a ransom to save us. In these closing chapters of the gospel, we learn much about God's love, and we learn much about God's justice. God the Father accepts no easy excuses for sin. It was by Christ's atoning sacrifice once offered at the cross It was by that sacrifice alone that God's justice is satisfied. Now, the central character in all of these events is, of course, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. But as we read these gospel accounts, we also notice that certain other minor characters, let's call them, make an appearance. And a number of these characters are mentioned by name. King Herod and Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, representing human justice and civil government. The chief priests and rulers of the Jews, the members of the Sanhedrin, who represented the old covenant and human religious authority. And the people of Jerusalem, representing sinful humanity, that cried out, "Crucify him, crucify him." And then there are also Jesus' own disciples, the ones who followed Jesus for 3 years, the ones whom he had taught personally, with whom he had such close and abiding fellowship. What a crew they were. Judas Iscariot, who ate the Passover meal, the Last Supper, with the Lord Jesus, his master, and then he went right out and betrayed the Lord for 30 pieces of silver. Philip, who told Jesus that he would be satisfied if Jesus would show him God the Father. What a request. Peter, who declared forcefully that though everyone else would desert Jesus, he would never, ever leave the Lord Jesus. What a bunch. I believe that we Christians today often think, although we don't dare say it out loud, but we think it that we would have behaved differently. It's so easy to think, well, I would not have betrayed the Lord. I would have been satisfied with Jesus' teaching. He would not have to show me God the Father. I never would have denied Jesus 3 times. No. The disciples don't look so good here in these gospel accounts. They do not appear in any way heroic, let alone faithful. And to top it off, there's the information that we have right here in our text this morning, Matthew 26, verse 56. When Jesus was arrested, when the time of his greatest suffering was beginning, the disciples left him. They fled away, the Bible tells us. That was their reaction to what was happening to their master there at the Garden of Gethsemane. When Jesus' ultimate sufferings were beginning, their response was, "Let's get out of here." Our text is recorded in Scripture right here in its place for a purpose. Let us turn our attention to this now and see what this account of the fleeing disciples has to teach us here this morning. Our text begins with one little word, then. Then. This word answers a simple question: at what time? At what time did the disciples flee away from Jesus? Was it when, on Palm Sunday, the crowds there that lined the streets leading to Jerusalem were waving palm branches and shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David"? No, it wasn't then. Was it earlier when up in Galilee, crowds gathered adoring Jesus because he healed the sick and taught them amazing things? No. No, it wasn't then. The disciples fled away at the moment of testing. And such a time came for the disciples long ago at the Garden of Gethsemane. And dear Christians, such a time will come for us. Now, Canada was established as a Christian nation. It really was. When the French and British established their colonies here, they brought with them the church, and they established the church, the Roman Catholic Church in Quebec, the Anglican Church here in Canada. These churches were established, they were paid for by tax money. The people were expected to attend and participate. And even when that came to an end, and these churches were no longer officially established churches, state churches, still, for generations, Christianity was the majority, the only religion in many places in Canada. And even if people didn't personally believe, for generations they outwardly conformed to Christian values. And it was Christian values that established public policy here in Canada. But how times have changed. That is certainly no longer the case, not at all. Only a small and growing ever smaller, it seems, minority of people even bother to attend church in Canada on any given Sunday. Public policy is certainly no longer guided and directed by Christian values. Now, when our faith meets with public approval, well, then it's easy to stand by the Lord. When we find it no difficulty to serve the Lord, at least outwardly, because everyone around us is doing the same thing, and that's what is established public policy, then we have no temptation at all to flee away from Jesus. But the day comes, and we should expect it, that each and every one of us faces a time of testing, a season of trial. Perhaps it is at school, or on the job, or with the neighbors. And we discover that our faith and our Christian values do not meet with their approval, not at all. When we take a stand for Jesus Christ, when we take a stand upon the teachings of Scripture, we find that it no longer meets with public approval. When Christians take a stand for life, we find ourselves in direct opposition to public policy and the opinions of the majority that are in favor of abortion and euthanasia. When we take a stand for morality, we're called old-fashioned, Puritans, Victorians. Oh, there's nothing wrong with pornography and free love. Then, now, we face the same kind of temptation as did the disciples here in our text. Be ready, Christian, for a time of testing. Be ready then for your faith and the quality of your commitment to Jesus Christ to be proved. Then you will show Jesus how much you love him. Then you will display your true colors. Then you will either build up your faith and the fellowship of the church or cast it down. Jesus faced his time of testing. Those who follow the Master will also be put to the test. Take up your cross, said Jesus, and follow me. We too are called to honor the Lord by enduring suffering. With this promise in 2 Timothy 2, verse 12, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. Our text goes on to say, all the disciples. There are times when we stand proudly as individuals. And there are other times when we're glad to be part of a group. So it is with our religion, our Christian faith. At times, we stand as an individual. When we make our profession of faith, we stand before the Lord and the congregation, and we declare our own personal commitment, our love for the Lord, our trust in him, our desire to serve him according to his word, a personal decision, a personal commitment. And there are other times when we are glad to be part of a group, the fellowship of the church, where we are encouraged by brothers and sisters in the faith. Now, society around us for the longest time has preached extreme individualism. Be your own man. Be your own woman. And this attitude, so common all around us, begins to rub off on us spiritually, and that is not good. We can begin to think of ourselves as better or more gifted or more pleasing to God than others in the fellowship. This we see among the disciples. Bold Peter, earlier in the chapter, it's recorded in verse 33, he declared, though they all fall away because of you, Jesus, I will never fall away. Too often, this is typical of our thinking. Though others sin, I will obey. Though others have their faults, I'm practically perfect. Though others are barely spiritual, I am a pillar of faith. Though others fail in the time of testing and trial, I will endure. And it's just not so. When the moment came there at the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus obeyed his Father in heaven. Jesus acted in a manner most perfect. Jesus was a pillar of trust in the Father's will. Jesus obeyed and endured. But the rest? The eager evangelist Andrew, bold Peter, James, John, Simon the Zealot, Philip, all the rest, all of them acted in the same way. Not one was perfect, not one was steadfast. As the scriptures say, all the disciples forsook him. They left Jesus. They did not stand by him. In fear, they took off. They had promised to stand with the Lord, but they discovered that it was one thing to promise, it's quite another to perform. Oh yes, how bitter that is. And what suffering that added to Jesus' burden. That the disciples, those with whom he had so labored, whom he had personally taught, who had his blessed perfect example constantly before them, they all forsook him. It was no longer easy. It was no longer convenient to serve the Lord. So they forsook him. It was the natural reaction of human nature. It was no longer easy. And so they forsook the Lord. When reality took hold upon them, when they realized that they would find themselves in peril, they wanted to avoid it. Their claims had been so great, they would never forsake him. But when reality took hold, when they saw that sharing with Jesus at that very moment would lead to danger, they scurried off like rats abandoning a sinking ship. And, says our text, they fled. Our text adds these words, that they not only forsook Jesus, but they fled. Where did they go? Did they have some kind of master plan? No, not at all. Their flight was without reason. It was just every man for himself. At that moment, they wanted out of a terrifying situation. They did not want to be identified as Jesus' disciples. So they fled away from the Garden of Gethsemane and lost themselves in the narrow, winding pathways there in the countryside around the Mount of Olives. Until at last, when the gates of Jerusalem were opened, they snuck into the city and regrouped in the upper room without the Lord. Rather than stand with Jesus, they fled. Such was the reaction of the disciples when the time of Jesus' sacrifice was at hand. So the Bible records it, and it records it to teach you and me something important. Over the centuries, many Christians have found it convenient to criticize the disciples. Oh, they were so slow to understand. They were so slow to believe. They doubted. They denied the Lord. They forsook him and they fled. During this season of Lent, as we are leading up to Good Friday and Easter, no doubt many passages of Jesus' passion will be read from this pulpit and sermons preached on this. And in our own personal devotions, no doubt we will turn to these chapters often at this time of year. If your reaction is merely to compare yourselves with the disciples and to figure that, well, compared to their pathetic performance, I look pretty good, then I fear that this whole exercise is wasted. From earliest days, the church has used these days leading up to Good Friday as a season of penitence, as a time to remember the price that Jesus Christ paid, not just for the sins of others, but for your sins and mine. Our text speaks of all the disciples forsaking Jesus and fleeing. There is an application here for us too. The way of the Christian life, the way that we are walking through life with the Lord, is the way of the cross. A cross of persecution, shame, loss, trial, and struggle. If we want to be a disciple of Jesus, then we must take up our cross and follow the Lord. But at the moment of persecution, at the moment of shame, when people around us look at us strangely because we will not join with them in their sin, then the human reaction right then and there is to forsake the world, the Lord, and flee from him. Don't think that it will never happen to you. All the disciples, says our text, all the disciples, not one was spared the test. Not you, not me, in our day and age. Your knowledge, your religious experience, your boldness of character, all these things cannot help you to stand. The disciples had those human qualities. Some of them had them in abundance, but they all forsook Jesus and fled. What we need, what you need in your walk with the Lord, what I need in mine, is God's grace. That divine grace that turns a sinner into a saint, a fainting soul into a pillar of faith, a dying ember into a fire for the Lord. Do you seek that grace of God? Do you seek it in prayer, in scripture reading? Do you seek it here in God's house as his word is proclaimed Sunday by Sunday? Do you live in that grace of God? Do you live by that grace of God? Without it, you will be a fleeing disciple, fleeing the Lord's will like Jonah, fleeing the way of the cross like the disciples at the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember, all your good human qualities cannot supply this need. The need to stand with Christ, the need to stand for Christ, that need only God can supply, and he supplies it by his grace. Dear Christian friends, in this season leading up to Good Friday and Easter, make that needed effort. Seek the grace of God. May these days truly be a time for you, a time of repentance and renewed consecration, so that you will be found not as one who forsakes Christ and flees from him, no, but one who follows him, walking the way of the cross as you live before the Lord each day of your life. Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we confess that in and of ourselves we are weak, and in human strength alone we would never be able to take a stand with your Son, Jesus Christ. But like the disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane, we would forsake him and flee. So it is that we pray you will pour out your grace upon us, that your Spirit will cause us to seek that grace where it may be found, here in church by the means of grace, in our personal devotions and prayer, so that strengthened by your grace, we will indeed be a true disciple, a follower of Jesus, taking up our cross and following him. We pray this for Jesus' sake. Amen. A reminder that an offering will be taken at the rear of the sanctuary as you exit, and this Sunday, The cause is for missions, particularly for Resonate Global missions. And now we respond with a song.
Let's stand up and sing.
Merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, Root of Bethlehem, rescue the souls of men. Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Our service draws to its conclusion. It's been a joy for me to share this time of worship once again with the congregation here. And remember, coffee will be served after the service. If you're able to stay, please do. And now lift up your hearts and receive from the Lord his benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all evermore. Amen.